Oh my goodness.
That is federal ground.
Yeah.
I agree. Yeah. Okay.
That's federal ground. And I don't blame them. I wouldn't want them on there either.
Oh, the White House steps, you know.
You know, unless the cattle were actually trained in traffic laws and stuff like that, and crosswalk laws and all of that, the cattle would be non-productive on federal ground.
Yeah. The deer are doing pretty good in Burns. You see them walking to the crosswalks and crossing now.
They're pretty fat, too. It's the fattest deer I've ever seen. My goodness, Hardy County. Burns, Oregon, feeds them well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and that's like when the fences occurred up here around the courthouse, I drove up there and I looked at that and it just upset me. What is this when we have to fence in our jail? You know, if the jail isn't strong enough to hold the inmates, maybe it should be beefed up.
Something.
And a phony fence that anybody could drive around or through.
Fire,
you know,
feathers,
it's just a symbolic gesture. You know, it's ridiculous. It just, to me, it just upset me. So I called the Burns City Council. I called one of them, their council people. What the hell's going on here? We got chain link fences across city streets. Don't we have ordinances, you know? Don't we have requirements for fences? Height requirements and where they can be? Is there something in our local ordinances that says that you can put a chain link fence across the city street? Well, no. And I said, so why is that being allowed? Can I fence my street off? No. Why? Because you go to jail. And I said, so why were they allowed to do that? Because they asked. They felt they needed protection. I said, okay, I'll be at the next council meeting. Why? I said, I want to fence my street off. There are some extremely dangerous looking deer in this community. And I fear more from a deer than I do from the refuge. And if I feel threatened, and I want to fence my street off, then I want to fence my street off to protect myself from these vicious deer.
Oh, goodness. Perish the thought. They do.
What, you know, what's the difference? How often have you ever been kicked by a deer?
Or stomped by them.
Have you ever walked up to a deer that you thought was dead, and all of a sudden you got hooked?
No, but I've never hunted, but I've heard of people that get their butts whooped.
I have rolled down the hill. I've rolled down the hill in Colorado with one that I thought was done. I lost a great pocket knife and a watch. And my buddy stood up there on the top of the hill and laughed his butt off. He said, that's the funniest thing I ever seen in my life. When I wound up in a pile of brush down at the bottom with my legs scissored around the abdomen of a deer, and I had my head stuck on the back of his, you know, my chin was on the back of his head. And I had his antlers in both hands so that I was protected. And I kept telling him, come shoot this sucker. You know?
Help me.
And he says, no, it looks like it's too slick down there. He says, I don't think I could get down there. He says, that's the funniest thing I've ever seen in my life. And I said, you know, you're talking danger there.
Yeah. That is terrible danger.
Stern jokes. The goat women get stomped all the time trying to feed those deer apples and that. They get beat them and they want more and more and they don't have no more and then they get stomped.
Right.
Those front feet start working. They'll kill a dog with those front feet.
In a heartbeat.
Yeah.
I've seen it.
Same with the deer elk.
And, that's great. You're just so calm and when you say that and stuff, but you're right. You're absolutely right. You know the spotlights into that poor man's home that's disabled down there?
Yeah.
I mean, I asked them that. I said, guys, there's no threat. You even openly admitted that there's really no threat from the people that are coming into this area. Mm-hmm. Think that we all are responsible. So why are you doing this? And they said, well, that's our PO. And I put a live stream up on that.
Yeah, that's their PO. But what happens to the rights of the people that live around the courthouse?
They have no rights.
Well,
and it's like scary.
Well, all I can say this morning, thank you, Mr. FBI. There's 3 people killed by a terrorist or somebody else in a military base down there in San Diego this morning. Military hospital. They're not sure if it was a terrorist or what, but why weren't they down there protecting that damn hospital?
Yeah.
Protecting our military men. Or if they're up here protecting a gopher hiding in this damn hole in that courthouse. Instead of protecting our military bases.
Yeah.
They got so damn many cops out there that could be protecting our military bases. Now that we got three dead military men, and what are they doing? They're up here playing their little games.
Well, and, you know, to give the devil his due, a lot of these law enforcement people, they're just people that have a job, and they're doing as they're told.
Mm-hmm.
And I would imagine that if you were to take a poll, a lot of them really don't want to be here.
Yeah.
They're here because they're told they got to be here.
I talked to many.
There's a lot of them that you know, just like after the high school thing where I kept it a secret about the FBI until I had the microphone in my hand in front of all them crazy cameras. There was a sheriff deputy that asked me, he said, "Tell me what happened," and I told him, and he says, "Damn them. We have told them and told them and told them to knock that crap off."
Yeah.
He says, I will talk to him again. He says, this is not right. That's a sheriff deputy talking to me after I leave the high school, you know, out in the parking lot of the high school, you know, which just did nothing more than to further confirm that, yeah, they're here. Yeah, they're doing this crap. They're doing this against what a lot of these law enforcement people are doing. You know, they're the ones that are running around scaring people's kids and stuff like that. It's just ridiculous.
Well, how many times have you heard about undercover FBI agents giving live explosives? I was on a job myself, an undercover job, where it was supposed to be a nerd, and it turned out to be live. The 93 World Trade Center explosion was FBI creating the event, encouraging these guys to do stuff, and then gave them the very explosives that was used in that document. So every time you look, there's squirrels inside of these agencies that are creating these narratives, that are actually giving over the very implements of the crime itself.
Oh. Look at Fast and Furious.
Fast and Furious, right. We're
talking about terrorism and its finest. Let's give it to the drug lords so the drug lords can kill American border crossing. What did our DOJ over there in Washington, D.C. do? Oh, he didn't do nothing. What did our president do? Oh, bury it. We don't need to know about that. Never happened. There's no conflict there.
So you've got good agents that express concern. I have heard this myself. I would go talk to him. There was I can't mention his name on camera, but he had his son followed, and he was scared for their safety and had a 3% sticker on it. Well, you know, after all this is said and done, I know the 3%ers. Nobody's followed or tailing anybody.
Exactly.
At all. And he knows this. And what's happened is I heard on the squawk box, a lot of officers are stopping people so much because they're trying to find out who are feds and who aren't, because they're worried for the citizen's safety. Folks, good officers in this area, men like Chris, are out there protecting their citizens, and they're having to pull their own people over to find out who these squirrels are that are coming in.
And then we're told we have no right to talk to anybody in our community.
Yeah.
And I have no right to ask anybody any questions, and it's absolutely none of my business what's going on in the armory that's in the city limits that I live in.
A lot of people don't know there's even such a thing as an armory in the city limits, but there is.
Yeah. And it's on. And well, to my knowledge, it's unoccupied. Who knows?
But still, there was various attempts and activities under the guise of something of patriots that they're talking about, that they're trying to demonize. And now I hear from other sources that the people that are involved with the BLM stuff or with the court systems are all told to look out for people like Payne or other people when in fact there is no threat. But they're told, and there's to such a degree that they're terrible, and that they're shadowed, and they're, we're protecting them. Who are they protecting them from? From people like us to talk to them?
No.
What, I mean, it's the law enforcement agencies out here, the big wigs that's come in, are the ones terrorizing the citizens.
Well, it could be job security, you know, if they make sure that everybody's afraid, then they'll feel that they need to be protected.
Right.
Hi, Margie.
No, that's fine. No, we're not talking. This is open talk.
Look them over this way.
mind is very clear and present that good people within law enforcement out here are trying to do a responsible thing, and that they all are starting to get an understanding that the reason this happened is because due process of law was ignored by the people of Hardy County because of that redress agreement. And until we get to the bottom of this and allow that evidentiary evidence to come forward for people of responsibility within this county, we're going to have this problem.
Well, and the law enforcement people are being used as pawns.
I mean, they're in the middle. And I feel for them. I feel so.
And the poor guys, they're only doing what they think that they're supposed to be doing or what they're told to do, but they're being used in an illegal manner.
Well, what they do is they'll roll up and talk to me. I've had many conversations sitting there, and they'll pull up at the Silver Spur over there. And we'll sit for 30 minutes talking, and I'm not fearful. I just say, I have a responsibility as a reporter to tell you what the truth is. Not my spin. This is what the facts are. And then we talk about some of the guns that I've worked on and things, and we have some guns on the ground, because I've worked with SWAT teams and things. But brother to brother, you know, we all realize that this is about our baby's future. This is about the sanctity and harmony of the people of Harney County. That's what I look at. And how much you can get a fair, balanced legal system that everybody can count on. And so far, what I've heard from everyone is that it has been one-sided, biased, with selective enforcement. And that if you have somebody that may work in the system, there's a strong chance that there's never been a seen there before. And I've heard some very, very serious allegations with some evidence out here, even some of the shenanigans with the last sheriff. And some things with one individual that I don't have the proof for, but he had indiscreet actions with a lady, and that DNA evidence was provided, and that was shoveled underneath the ground. You know what I'm talking about?
Oh yes, I do.
And I'm looking at that. If that is true, and that there was DNA evidence provided, how is that individual still wearing a badge? That is an impossibility with me, and to understand how that is possible. And so that tells me that the court system out here committed the most grievous crime of trust. And that situation right there, that one alone should make open up a citizen's grand jury, a people's grand jury, on the criminality and intent of this court system out here. That's where I'm at, because that means that people are not protected, and that individual is still on course to do this more. And how much other harmful intent? Folks, harmful intent is a measure of a crime. Aggressive. It's beyond the shadow of a doubt he's committing harmful intent. And unfortunately, we have a sheriff that is sitting back that is coddled and told lies. We think that, Ward, we know you're a good man, but you need to have leadership and step up to the plate and look at these crimes that are committed and be a man. Because other sheriffs in Grant County are being men. And I think it's time for you to step forward. These gentlemen here are your neighbors. Why won't you come to their aid? This is what I have to say, and I don't know. For me, I'm an outsider, but I fell in love with Harney County and the people here.
Well, we're kind of lovable.
I want to move here, tell you the truth.
Yeah, I want to move to Harney County.
Well, the harassment I'm getting,
hey, you come to Harney County,
maybe we'll all move out of the
county. Well, I'm staying here.
I'll show you some places.
I see the views. It's beautiful.
But so this is just about being real. There's no spin here. There's no agenda. There's just an agenda of light of love and light of truth. It's all we really need in the court system. Compassion on the court. The jury having responsibility. And what's the facts? How hard is that? Oh, I'm sorry if it's the governor, or I'm sorry if it's this, or I'm sorry if it's that. But if you committed a crime, you do the time.
Well, and I agree. You know, it's like a huge game. It's just a game that's being played here.
He's called the criminal and justice system.
And,
too.
And if people want to play games, you can go and buy chess or checkers or whatever you want anywhere. Play Monopoly. Play Harney County Monopoly. You know, there's actually, it was a game out there, Harney County Monopoly.
Was there really?
Oh, yeah. And I've got one at home. You know, there wasn't very many of them. But, you know, play a game somewhere else. You know, all the years that I was on the ambulance, sometimes you go out, you might drive over 100 miles to get to the patient, and they needed an ambulance when it was called, they needed an ambulance, and maybe it's an hour and a half before you could get there. And so how do you make decisions about what to do with them, you know, and all of that, you know, when you get out here, it's a life or death situation, maybe. If that's even in your mind, I've told so many people down through the years, well, I don't really even think I should go to the hospital, you know, and I feel fine. And I would always tell them, if you want to gamble, take something that you can afford to lose and gamble with that. Go throw your money in a slot machine, but you don't ever gamble with human lives. You do not do that. You always err to the patient's betterment. If you over-treat someone and they feel even better than they did, you haven't harmed anything. But if you don't do anything and someone dies, then how do you reverse that? You can always earn more money, but you can't earn a new life. You know, don't gamble with things you can't afford to lose. And there's a game here. And there's a game here where they're gambling with people's lives. And it's absolutely ridiculous to me for people to gamble with people's lives. I'm important to somebody. You're important to somebody. You know, everybody is important to somebody.
Those officers' lives are important.
Those officers' lives are important. How do you think that their families feel when they're hearing all of this stuff and all of these horrible rumors and everything? How does a wife of an officer feel that their officer, their husband is over here and they're perceived to be in an incredibly dangerous situation? What about the little girl that he bounced on his knee before he come over here? Or the little boy? How did they feel about daddy and being over here in such a tremendously dangerous situation when it's not dangerous at all, and these families are being put through mental hell.
And on both sides of the fence.
On both sides.
You've got men out there that responded trying to protect these people out there that said, I'll see you on the other side. And the only tears they had is what they may have to do to defend these people for men that maybe are their brothers.
Exactly.
And so I'm going out there with a live stream to stop a fight, just like on the rollout, so we can communicate. Right, these people, we went out there and talked to you, brother and brother. You've talked to many of these men on both sides of the fence. Do you see any difference between us?
No, I went last count. They all had the same amount of arms and legs and ears and eyes.
Okay, how about this? We all have people we love, and I want their babies to have a future. I know that,
and the babies,
the children's great grandchildren. We have a responsibility.
I want the Constitution to be.
Brandon. Oh, no, I'm talking. Is it for me? She's going to have to call back.
I think that, you know, Tom was talking about an oath. You took an oath.
I'm in a meeting.
To support your Constitution, you know, in the United States of America. And there are so many police officers out there that take the same type of oath. Mm-hmm. But they're just holding their hand up, and they're reciting words that are spoken to them, and they don't understand what the words mean. They don't understand. They're not familiar with our Constitution, and yet they're swearing upon a Bible to uphold it. I think that every law enforcement agency out there, whether it be sheriffs, city police, state police, whatever, I think when they go to their conferences and they go to their trainings, that they should be taught what the Constitution is so that they have an idea of what it is that they're supporting. I mean, you know, I an oath is a very, very important thing. And it's not about just repeating some words you don't understand. It should mean something.
But when we see on like our president with the terrorists that he just created five generals for one little traitorous little doll, why do they think the Constitution did? This guy went and betrayed the Constitution, turned on the American people. And what for? Or he wanted to go to Taliban. He said it in his diaries. He said it in the books. And the president put him and his family on the Rose Garden and made them heroes. For the world, that they're heroes because he turned on his people. No. So why should people even bother with the Constitution when the number one man in the United States of America can't honor it?
Right.
No. I don't know. I was sitting on watching the comment in the comment sections there for a long time. I wasn't going to get involved. I wasn't going to keep my mouth shut. I wasn't going to say nothing. Finally, I said, bullshit. Every one of these people making their comments about go home or we want Hamas home, not one of them has proposed a plan to make sure that they're protected and they're not harassed anymore. They said, well, we can do it the legal means. The legal means have been exhausted. We have tried everything in legal means. The war is coming upon us. The soldiers are built up right here, sitting on us. Now, you think they're after the Bundys? No, this is to show them